Welcome back once again. Today I'm going to discuss about HTTP Hypertext Transfer Protocol. The topics discussed are HTTP transaction, message format, persistent and non-persistent connection, proxy server. HTTP is used mainly to access data on www, that is World Wide Web. You all may be familiar with that. It actually functions as a combination of FTP and SMTP. FTP means file transfer protocol, SMTP, simple mail transfer protocol. So HTTP acts as a combination of these two. Both of these we have discussed earlier. Similar to FTP, it transfers files and uses services of TCP. So HTTP also uses the services of TCP. But it is simpler than FTP as it uses only one TCP connection. Actually, as you know, FTP is having two connections, data connection and control connection. But in the case of HTTP, it needs only one TCP connection. Or in other words, there is no separate control connection, only data is transferred by using HTTP. Now comparing with SMTP, it is similar to SMTP because the data transferred look like SMTP messages. We have already discussed about the format of SMTP message, and the HTTP message also look like SMTP messages. The HTTP messages, they are not destined to read by humans. They are read and interpreted by HTTP server and HTTP client. HTTP client in the sense browser. The users are using the browser to access data in the web. So browser is the HTTP client. Another important difference is that HTTP messages are delivered immediately, whereas SMTP messages are stored and forwarded. And coming to the port number, HTTP uses port number, well-known port number 80. And the format of this message, HTTP message, is controlled by MIME-like header, multi-purpose mail extension protocol. The header are it is controlled by, the messages are controlled by MIME-like headers. And about the commands, the commands from the client to the server are embedded in a request message. That is, we, in the sense client sitting on a browser, is trying to serve something on the web. So we are actually making a request for something from the web or from the server. So the commands, that's what we are telling, that the commands from the client to the server are embedded in a request message. Whatever we are typing on the browser, that is the client side, is a request message. And the server in turn will give a response or will provide us with whatever we are searching. So the contents of the requested file or the other information are embedded in a response message. The figure shows a simple representation of HTTP transaction. That here this is a client and this is a server, and the request goes from client to the server and response is coming from server to the client. So as I told, we are searching for something on the web. We in the sense the client. So it is the client who initialized the transaction by sending the request message. And once getting the request from the client, the server responds. And the format of request and response messages are somewhat similar. We can see it in detail. So here, this is the request message, the format of request message, and this is the format of response message. Both are having similar fields, the header, headers, a blank line, body. These three are common fields, but the difference is in request line and the status line. We can check out. So request and status line, that is the first field of the request message and the response message. So here is the request line, here is the format of the status line. The request line, the first part is a request type, and then the space is there, URL is there, then space is there, and HTTP version. So these two you may be familiar, it is clear for you. URL means URL of the server, and this is the version of HTTP we are using. And here in the case of status line, the same thing, HTTP version comes, and the two other fields are status code and status phase. So we can see in detail. So request type, coming to request type, it is categorized into several methods. So request type is a part of request line, which is the first field in the request message, that is from client to the server. So we can see those methods. These are the methods, and the corresponding action is given here. For example, if the method is get, it requests a document from the server. Or if it is a post, it sends some information from the client to server. Like that, we have many methods. This I have already told, URL is a result of the record page, and version is version of HTTP. Now we can check the status codes and status phrase, which are present in the status line, or which are part of the response message. So here are codes, and these are the status phrase. And actually, the status phrase explains the status code in a text form. For example, if status code is 100, then phrase is continue. Means if we are giving the code as 100, then it means continue. Or if we are giving the status code as 200, it means okay. So this is actually status code and status phrase. This is used in status codes and status phrase are used. Phrase are used in response message only. So the second field in both request message and response message is a header. So we can see the header format. So there's a header name, colon, and header value. So actually, what's the purpose of a header? It is for exchanging additional information between the client and the server. Some additional information in the sense, we can take the example, request a document in some special format. That is, request a document which is, the documents are usually given using a particular format. Sometimes we may need it in a different format, some special format. If something is like that, it will be mentioned in the header portion. And the headers are classified into general header, request header, response header, and entity header. And these four headers need not be present in both request message and response message. From the name itself, you can identify that request header and response header means this is present in the request message and this is present in the response message. So we can see that a request message can contain only general, request and entity header, whereas a response message can contain only general, response and entity headers. So taking the general header, it gives a general information about the message. So it is not about the client, it is not about the server, it is actually a general information about a message, and it can be present in both the request and response message. Some of the general headers and descriptions are shown. You can go through this. So next is request header. So request header can be present only in the request message. And as far as request header is considered, it specifies the client's configuration, because request message is made by the client. So it will contain the client's configuration and the client's preferred document format. And some of the request headers are shown in the table. Now coming to response header. So response is made by the server. So naturally, it is present only in a response message, and also as it is coming from the server, it specifies the server's configuration and special information about the request. And some response headers are given for reference. We can go through it. And coming to entity header. So we have general header for some specific informations, request header regarding the client side, the request message, and response header about the server's configuration and the format. And the last is entity header. The remaining is about the body. So it contains information about body of the document, and mostly present in response messages. There are some special cases, some request messages. If for example, take the case of post or put methods that contain a body, also use this type of header. Not all, only some specific type of request messages may contain entity header. Some examples are given for reference. So next is body part. This present, it can be present in a request or response message. Usually it contains a document to be sent or received. Sent from the client to the server or received from the server by the client. Persistent and non-persistent connection. First one, non-persistent connection. Here, one TCP connection is made for each request or response. Request is from the client to the server, and response is from the server to the client. So for each request or response, one TCP connection is made. Whereas in a persistent connection, the server will make a response, and after that it will keep the connection open for more requests. So that is the difference or comparison between a non-persistent and persistent connection. So in the case of non-persistent, for each and every request and response, we need one TCP connection. Whereas in the case of persistent connection, the server will leave the connection open once a response is made. So in the case of non-persistent connection, the steps are, first the client open. Naturally we know the connection is initialized by the client. So the client opens a TCP connection and sends the request. So on receiving this request, the server will send a response and then it closes the connection. So from the server side, the connection is now closed. After that, the response reaches the client. So the client will read the data until it encounters the end of the marker. That is, till the end of the file, the client will read it. Once it is over, the client will close the connection. That is, at first the client opens a connection, sends a request. After that, the server will send a response and will close the server side. Client now will read, and once the reading is complete, it will close the connection. And suppose the client wants to send one more request, the same procedure is repeated. Here I am giving an example. If there are n different pictures in different files, so we must open and close the connection n times. Actually, this imposes high overhead because the server needs n different buffers and requires a slow start procedure each time the connection is opened. Now, persistent connection, as I told you earlier, the server leaves the connection open for more requests once it sends a response. Now the question is, when to close this connection? The server is leaving the connection open, so anyway it has to close it. So when this connection get closed? So server can close this connection at the request of the client. So client has to make a request that its requirement is over, so we can close it, or if a timeout has been reached. The sender usually sends the length of data with each response. Sender in the sense, whenever we are trying to catch something from the web, that is from the web server, we will say response message. Actually, the data is with the response message. So the sender, that is the server, will usually send the length of the data with each response. But sometimes there may be a change, that is, sometimes the sender does not know the length of the data. The situation is something when the document is created dynamically or actively. So in the case of dynamic creation of documents, knowing the length is not possible. In these cases, the server will inform the client that the length is not known and will close the connection after sending data. That is, the sender, that is server, will send the response message and also informs the client that the length is not known. So once it is over, the connection gets closed. So now the client knows that the end of the data has been reached, so it can close the connection. That is about persistent connection. And one more is that HTTP version 1.1 specifies a persistent connection by default. Earlier versions, it was not like that, but 1.1, the persistent connection is the default connection. Proxy server. HTTP supports proxy servers. You know what is meant by proxy. If a person stands on behalf of somebody else, then the first person is known as a proxy. Same way, here also, there is a server which acts on behalf of the server. And it is known as the idea of proxy server. Or in other words, a proxy server is a computer that keeps copies of responses to recent requests. So client is making requests, and all these requests are kept in a proxy server, so kept in another machine known as the proxy server. So whenever an HTTP client sends a request to a proxy server, once there is a proxy server, HTTP client will send the request to the proxy server only. So when this request comes to the proxy server, the proxy server will check its cache. If the response is there, already there, then the proxy server will give the response from that cache. If the response is not stored in the cache, then the proxy server will send this request to the corresponding server. All the incoming responses are sent to the proxy server, and it is stored for future requests from other clients. In other words, all the incoming responses are there in the proxy server, are stored in the proxy server, and whenever other clients make requests for those pages or for those documents which are stored in proxy server, the responses are initiated from the proxy server. If it is not there, only the requests are forwarded to the corresponding server. And why we are using this proxy server? Actually, proxy server reduces the load on the original server. It decreases the traffic, and hence it improves latency and efficiency. The only thing is that in order to use a proxy server, the client must be configured to access the proxy server. This is because under normal conditions, the clients are configured to access the actual server, the target server, known as the target server. And if we are using the idea of proxy server, then the clients must be configured to access that proxy server. So that's the end of this session. Thank you.